window.
Aren't you in the wrong room, Mr. Bond?
Not from where I'm standing.
Really, 007.
Welcome and good evening, everyone, to the Really 007 podcast. I'm Tom Pickup, and tonight I'm joined by Mr. John Kell.
Hello.
And we are celebrating 60 years of James Bond with someone who we consider to be the greatest female villain in the series. We really can't believe this. We are here today talking with Luciana Paluzzi, who of course played Spectre agent Fiona Volpe from Thunderball. Yeah, unbelievable stuff. Anyway, you can find all our interviews on our YouTube channel, and you can listen to them and more on iTunes and Spotify. We're on social media, where you can find daily interaction on all subjects James Bond, and we're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And I can already tell you, Luciana, that we have discussed Fiona Volpe many times, and she's a source of great love in the fandom, a much-loved character. So yes, John is with me, and we just can't believe that we're talking to one of Sean Connery's finest Bond girls. Just to give a little introduction to Luciana, she is a star of Italian cinema, and of course, she made her name in Hollywood too. But of course, we know her best for her part as the villainous Fiona Volpe in Thunderball. If I start asking questions about yourself growing up in Rome, I mean, what was that like growing up in Italy as a young aspiring actress?
Well, actually, I didn't want to be an actress when I was young. Growing up in Italy is not such a bad thing, so I have only pleasant memories, but I did not want to be an actress. I wanted to be able to build and design ships.
Oh,
and
wow.
Not yachts, but huge ships. I don't know why I was enamored with the idea, but that's what I went to school for. So I went to, in Italy, we have two kinds of school, the classic and the scientific. And most of the girls take the classic because they teach you, you know, languages and Latin and all of that. And I went to the scientific courses, and I was mostly among boys, but that's what I wanted to do. But life, you know, intervenes with their own things and projects, and all of a sudden you're doing something else. And this happened, if you want to know the story,
happened
when one night I was having dinner with my dad, my mom, and friends of his, and I was about 14. My father's friends was a very recognized production manager, assistant director. He spoke five languages. So anytime a movie from the United States needed to have shots done in Italy, he would get the job because he was very well known for that. And so we were just chit-chatting at the table, and all of a sudden he's saying to my father, to everybody, Jean Negulesco is driving me crazy because for a role that only has two lines, he says he has seen I don't know how many girls and he doesn't like anybody. And that's really so silly. And as he's talking, his eyes laid on me, and something went through his head, and he said, Luciana, do you want to come up tomorrow? Now, you have to understand that my father was a colonel in the army, and for him, even being a ballerina alla Scala in Milano was something. He saw me as a teacher, as, you know, something very serious. The idea of being an actress was not appealing at the time. We're talking like a century ago. I'm exaggerating, but you know, the mentality was totally different from today. So, but because this was a very good friend of his, he thought it was, you know, just a fun thing, and he said, it's okay, you could go. So I went to the Grand Hotel in Rome with this friend of my dad, and I only knew a little joke, something in English. Sorry, you will hear my dog once in a while.
He's welcome.
I have two dachshunds.
Oh, lovely.
So Yeah, one blonde and one brown, and but one talks a lot. So anyway, I said my three words in English that I knew at the time, and Jean Niculescu, for some reason, liked me, and he said, yeah, Luciana is going to do this. So all of a sudden, I am on a plane going up to Bolzano, which is in the north part of Italy, and with my mom, and we're put in a beautiful hotel, and we're well taken care of, and I'm making money at age 14. And I said to my mom, I'm having such a good time. I said, this is really easy. I really would like to pursue this career. And I did. And for a year and a half, I went from two lines to four lines to six lines. And then after a while, I was playing, more substantial roles. And that's how I started my career as an actress.
Was it Three Coins in the Fountain? That was the film that you caught their eye. That was amazing.
Yes. Yeah. Three coins in the fountain,
each one seeking happiness. Right.
I played the little sister of Rossano Bracci.
Oh. Well, that's an amazing film to be introduced to, a big Oscar-winning film. Yeah.
It was wonderful, but it also was for the Italians only.
Well,
it was very funny because the scenes were supposed to be outside of Rome, which has, lovely hills. And instead, for some reasons, which I really didn't want to go into it, but we ended up shooting this in Bolzano where we have the Dolomites, with snow peaks and everything. And around Rome, none of that exists. So I remember going to see the movie in the cinema, and all the Italians were laughing when these scenes came up because they knew exactly that there was not Rome or the nearby Rome. So I don't think anybody has noticed,
No,
Hollywood movies,
no.
They're fun. Yeah.
You came to the attention, obviously, of Cubby Broccoli and Terence Young because you're in the film No Time to Die, the original.
I did two pictures with Terence before that. The No Time to Die and the Amazons, what's the title of that one? I didn't have a very big role, but he wanted to, since I'm only 5'4", he wanted to show how big the other girls were, so he put me there as the queen of something. It was just a fun thing. But when the time came for them to make the movie, they invited me to go to Pinewood to test with a lot of other ladies. There were a lot of actresses there. I remember going from makeup room to makeup room and say, oh my God, but another one. And there were like at least 40, 50 girls doing the test for the role of Domino, which was the love interest in the movie. And I did my test. I went back to Rome and I waited and nobody was calling. I didn't hear anybody. And then all of a sudden, like a couple of months later, I get a call from both Cubby and Harry. And they said to me, Luciana, they were both on the phone. And they said, we have good news and we have bad news. I always want to hear the bad news first because I always want to end up, in a nice note. So I said, okay, what's the bad news? He said, you didn't get the role of Domino. And I just went, my heart sank. I said, what could the good news be then? And they said, well, we didn't want to lose you. And the reason we didn't give you that role is because you have already made so many pictures and we want to launch a new face now. Every time we do a movie, we want to have an actress that nobody has heard of. We want to launch a new face. So you can't do that role because you already worked a lot. So we're going to give you, we thought because we didn't want to lose you. And we thought of changing the role of the villainess to an Italian. It was supposed to be an Irish girl.
Yeah.
Anyway, I said, but this is wonderful news because in my point of view, it's more fun to play a villain than to an ingenue. So that's how the story went.
We absolutely love the character of Volpe, and I think you landed a great deal with that, because we love Domino, of course, and she's a beautiful actress as well. But Volpe, we think, is the first proper evil Bond girl, but who was toe-to-toe with Bond, who didn't, you know, she wasn't like Rosa Klebb. She was glamorous, but she was also extremely formidable. Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
And was predominantly evil, not for turning to the good side like Pussy Galore. And even though you were a villain, you showed such strength of character as Fiona Volpe that I personally don't think the Bond series has seen since.
That's a wonderful compliment. I appreciate it. I want to have a copy of this conversation.
So we can send it to you.
I can have my grandchildren listen
to
it.
We do mean it, though, because they had a, I don't know whether you remember, they had a Xenia on the top later on, and there's no one really else who's come close until Xenia, but we always go back to Fiona Volpe, and I think we're not just saying it because we're speaking to you now, we do genuinely think you're the best thing in that film, and to be the best thing in the biggest ever Bond film in terms of box office, it's just crazy. I think you rightly should be extremely proud of your legacy as one of the best Bond girls.
Thank you.
Best Bond hench women and best Bond villains, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, this is a really a wonderful compliment, and would you call me back again tomorrow?
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Every day.
Yeah. And I mean,
every day. To start my day off with this. I'm getting an inch taller.
We do have to say, though, growing up and now, I mean, you're a genuinely beautiful lady as well. So there was that, we have to say.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So did he get on with Claudine Auger then?
Why would you ask that?
I was just interested because you obviously were meant for her part.
So. Okay. I got along better with Molly Peters and with Martine Beswick because I like people that are down to earth and that are humble. And no matter, you know, the bigger I found out in life that the bigger the actors, the most famous, the more humble and nice they are. The ones that are arrogant and full of themselves usually are not so good. They're, you know, whatever. And Claudine was a little bit too much for me. We didn't become friends.
Oh, okay. One thing that you had over her was that your voice was used, because Claudine and a lot of the other Bond girls around at the time were dubbed. So that's another string to your bow, and we got to hear your lovely Italian accent.
Well, yeah, I still have it. I haven't lost it. I lived in the United States, I don't know how many years. I can't get rid of it. But everybody says, it's okay, it's charming, who cares? And yeah, who cares? I'm not working anymore, so I don't have to prove anything. It is what it is.
I think one of the reasons why we asked about Claudine Auger was when we see pictures of Thunderball, we see such a happy set. There's so many pictures of yourself with the likes of Sean Connery and Martine Beswick and stuff. And we'd just love you to just share maybe some of the happy memories of filming Thunderball in the Bahamas.
Well, it was like the whole thing was like a fairy tale, because having done movies before and after, I still think that was the most fun movie to do. Reason being, Terence Young. Terence is the real James Bond. Terence is the one that really had all the little touches that he taught. See the Italian accent. He taught Sean, you know, to make things lighter and have a little fun and the sparkle in the eyes and the little funny things that he does in the picture, they were all Terence. And Terence was bigger than life. Terence was probably one of the most generous human beings I've ever seen. Anybody that had troubles, financial, marital, I don't care what it was, he was always there to listen to him. No, an incredible human being, really. And it was, as I said, bigger than life. I mean, we didn't have, like, in most movies, when you work, you have a, I don't know how you say it in English, where you have lunch, you know, they set up canteen, wherever,
the
on
buffet.
Location. And then you have, you know, tables that are thrown about and you sit wherever you can. Sometimes you sit on a rock, sometimes it doesn't matter. With Terrence, when we had, for instance, all the night sequences on the junk canoe, he had, on the sand, he had prepared a tent, a white tent, and underneath it was oblong. There was a long table with white tablecloth and candles, and the champagne was flowing.
Oh.
I mean, there is no other movie that I've ever done again that treated their actors with such luxury. We had to change. Sometimes I had to change in the bathrooms of a gas station when I was working here. They rented a yacht so that you could have, you know, time in between takes to go rest. And it was just an amazing, wonderful experience.
Oh, that's really good. A lot of the people we've spoken to from the Bond films say how good the set was, how good it was. Like a family feeling, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, a family feeling, I think it's practically in every movie. You really become a family after you work together night and day under whatever circumstances. But more than anything, there was a lot of, like, it was a happy feeling because, again, they knew by then that they had success in their hands. Harry and Cubby knew that everything was, you know, going to be okay. And sometimes on a set, if you have a cloud that comes over and doesn't match the previous scene, sometimes we had to wait, especially in the Bahamas where the weather changes so fast and furious. You had to wait between takes, and most producers and directors and the crew, everybody's upset because every minute costs, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars,
yeah.
Whatever. No, not on this picture. On this picture, everybody was like so calm and it's smiling and happy. There was never had such a happy feeling during a movie than while doing Thunderball. I got to meet Barbara was a baby. She was maybe, four years old. And my son was the same age. And I got to meet her, and still today, we are such good friends.
Oh.
She's wonderful. She's adorable. Yeah, she just invited Michael and I. Michael is my husband. She just invited us to London. We were there on the beginning of October.
Yes.
For his concert at the Royal Albert Hall, which was an incredible success. And it was just a wonderful evening. And we keep this relationship going. I mean, she's now, 62?
Yeah, I think so.
So I've known her since she was a baby, and she has not forgotten. You know, she's so kind and lovely. So that's, it's amazing.
That's wonderful.
And
I'm still
good friends with Martine. We see each other once in a while when she comes to Los Angeles or if I go to London. I'm very good friends with Marion Dabo.
Sorry
that Molly passed away, but I was thinking, really, it's very sad. Practically, except for Martine and I, everybody else in the movie is gone. From Terrence to Sean to Molly Peters to Claudine Auger.
Yeah.
I mean, very few of us are left. Ken Adams did all the sets. Everybody's gone. That's what happens when you grow old. You lose all your friends and people that you know and love.
I seem to see that you and Martine were invited to the event in the Bahamas this year to celebrate Thunderball. That must have been...
Yes, that was very fun.
That must have been quite emotional.
It was, because I hadn't been back there in a long time. And not only that, but they reconstructed this club.
Oh, yeah.
Where I get shot.
Yeah, we need to talk about that.
Bang, bang, whatever.
Yeah.
They reconstructed on the... And guess who I danced with? Instead of Sean, I danced with his son, Jason.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful.
I met when he was a little baby.
Oh.
Because he was there with Ian Silento. He was there during the filming for a couple of weeks, 3 weeks. So
yes.
I saw him when he was a really little baby. And now I met him again with his wife Fiona, and he's adorable, and he looks a lot like his dad.
Oh.
And he's really one of the nicest human beings. We had a good time. They invited us to their house for dinner. I had my two grandchildren with me, and we had a wonderful time. It was really a lot of fun.
That's so good to hear that, you know, you're keeping the legacy going. You're part of that. We actually spoke to Marianne, yeah. And I know that she spoke to you about the Bond Girls Are Forever documentary. And it's good that these people keep the next generation of Bond fans coming. Because I don't know whether you know, in the UK, to celebrate 60 years, all the Bonds were shown every week at the cinemas again. So we had the amazing... the cinema, one every week in order. So we saw Thunderball and yourself on the big screen, and because, you know, we're in our 30s. It was amazing to see it because we never saw it, of course, the first time round. I'm not saying it was as amazing as Bond Mania in the 60s, but my word, that film looks $1 million, doesn't it, on the big screen? It's a fantastic looking film.
If you think how many years ago it was made, today they use so much, they are helped by technical possibilities of instead of having 10 people, all of a sudden you can have 2,000. The thing is, it's like another movie that I made that is like, probably one of the worst movies you will ever want to see. But it has a following that it's incredible. It's called The Green Slime, and it was made for MGM. And it was like a science fiction movie that we made in Japan. And the director was Japanese, and it's so many years ago. And it had no help whatsoever. Technologically, it was really poor. And yet, the people just loved it. It has become like a tradition. They see it over and again, and everybody knows. And when I signed for it, it was called Battle Beyond the Stars.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, we finished the movie, and I remember I was in New York, and I went to dinner at the Copacabana, and there are the producers, and they said, "Oh, Luciana, we just changed the title." I said, "Oh yes, what are you calling it?" So we're going to call it The Green Slime, and I wanted to faint.
Oh dear!
Because I mean, this certainly is not an improvement on the Battle Beyond the Stars, but yet I have people that come up to me today, and they say, "Oh, we love that picture." So you never know.
Oh, that's all right.
You just never know.
I mean, it's incredible. You mentioned Sean's son. What was Sean like as a man? Because we've heard that because, like you say, the biggest stars are the most humble, and we've heard that about Sean as well, that he was a lovely gentleman.
You know, Sean was one of the most down-to-earth people I've ever met. He actually he didn't like the fuss he hated it. And at night, the mayor of the Bahamas would invite people for dinner, you know, Terrence and the stars and blah, blah, blah. He'd rather go out with the crew, with the boys. That's the way he was. He was a macho, fun person to be around. And, you know, you hear all these stories after about, you know, not being nice to women. I have no clue. I have no idea. No. He was always so nice to me. And I never saw a bad side of him. We stayed friends. We saw him in New York in his brownstone house that he had in New York. We went and had lunch with him and Michelin, my husband, the four of us. I have such wonderful memories of him being always very pleasant and funny.
That's so good to hear. I mean, so what was it like actually filming those scenes with him? Because you had some terrific scenes. The one in the bathtub. And then the famous with the in bed with the cages and all that.
Yeah, well, the one in the bathroom with the little slippers, again, that was Terrence's idea.
Oh, it was a great idea,
It was like it was not even in the script.
Oh, right, okay.
He just thought of it while we were there, you know. It was really a funny moment.
Since you're here, would you mind giving me something to put on? Anyway, I'm very glad to see you again, Mr. Bond.
I'm glad to see you again.
I had a feeling you've been avoiding me.
Well, you see, I had no idea that we were next door neighbors.
Oh, they just moved me down this afternoon. It's extraordinary, isn't it? Almost as if...
As if it was intended. Yes, it is extraordinary.
Shouldn't you get out those wet clothes?
You'll catch your death of cold.
And the one in the bed, I have no recollection except that I had 40 photographers around while we were shooting the scene, because they had brought in on a private plane, they chartered a plane to have all the journalists from Europe come to the Bahamas for 3 days and shoot whatever it was. And somehow, when we were shooting, we had all these people around taking photographs. And so that was, but actually, I'm sorry, I take this back. You know, it's many years ago, so I have to take it back. We shot that scene in Pinewood.
Oh, right,
so
okay.
So I don't know
right.
why. That day, they decided to have all these paparazzi and some really, actually, really good photographers. And I'm ashamed to say that I don't remember the name of one of them. Is really very good, because I was in Palm Beach in Florida walking down the street with friends recently, a few months ago, and there is a gallery, and we walk into the gallery, and hanging on the wall is a photograph in black and white of me and Sean, and it's signed by this photographer. And it's a big one. It's not an 8x10. It was a very big photograph. So I didn't say, that's me. I didn't say anything. I said, is that for sale? And they said, no, sorry, it's already sold. Somebody already bought it. And I asked, how much did they pay for it? And they said, $6,000.
Wow.
And I'm thinking $6,000 for a photograph in black and white? And they said, yes. He said, the photographer is very famous. And he took the picture while we were doing the scene. I mean, you could see it. It's Sean and I in bed. So I'm sorry that I don't remember the name of the photographer. I should have written it down.
That's incredible.
Now look, you know we're going to be too late.
Too late for what?
The junk canoe. I promised my friends I'd meet. Perhaps you know them, the Lagos.
Questions, questions. All I get is questions. But the music is going to go on all night anyhow. Enough to drive you wild.
Yeah.
Do you like wild things, Mr. Bond, James Bond?
Wild? You should be locked up in a cage.
This bed feels like a cage. All these bars. Do you think I'll be safe?
Obviously, after the scene of you and Sean in bed is, for me, the strongest scene in the whole film, where you do your speech to James about not this woman
yes.
who sings the heavenly choirs. And I mean, the writing on that is outstanding, but how you said that with such conviction, it's just amazing.
You made a shocking mess out of my hair, you sadistic brute. Will you sit me up, please?
I wonder you can get dressed so quickly. On the way, we can have a little talk. You may find it interesting. Come on.
I'm coming. I hate to think I'm going to miss anything. And now we can go somewhere for an interesting talk.
Friends of yours, no doubt. Come in.
You dress quickly, too. I didn't see that gun in the mirror.
Not that it matters, but that was under the pillow all the time.
And when did you find out?
Well, you're wearing the same ring as Largo.
It's a ring I like to wear.
Vanity has its dangers.
Vanity, Mr. Bond? Something you know so much about.
My dear girl, don't flatter yourself. What I did this evening was for king and country. You don't think it gave me any pleasure, do you?
I forgot your ego, Mr. Bond. James Bond, who only has to make love to a woman and she starts to hear heavenly choir singing. She repents and immediately returns to the side of right and virtue. But not this one.
What a blow it must have been. You having a failure.
Well, we can't win them all.
We'll take him out the front way. Go and get the car. Careful, Mr. Bond. Careful.
I just wondered if you could, if you remember any of the lines and you could possibly just recite any of them for us, please.
No. No, I can tell you a line in German for a picture I did with Fritz Lang, because for some reason, and I've been wanting to learn German and I understand it a little bit. I speak French and Italian and Spanish and English, and I wanted to learn German. But for some reason, this movie that I did when I was at 16, I remember line in German, like if it's yesterday, but I don't remember any of the lines of Thunderball. Sorry.
Well, they've gone down in immortality in terms of Bond fandom.
Yeah, I remember the first thing you say to Bond when you're in the car with him, you go on that car journey with him, you say, you'd better fasten your safety belt. I remember that. Because you're going at a frightening pace.
I remember that also.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember that. Yeah.
Can I have a lift?
Sure.
Thank you. You've just about saved my life.
Really?
My outboard capsized, so I had to swim ashore. How far do you go?
You better fasten your safety belt. What's your name?
James Bond.
Fiona Volpe.
You fly here often?
Do I make you nervous?
No, it's just that I have no desire to be capsized twice in the one night.
Well, at least you won't have to swim ashore. Have you been here before, Mr. Bond?
No, I haven't. But this is the road to Nassau.
Yes. Eventually.
Yes, me too. This is my hotel.
What a coincidence.
Yeah, it's so convenient.
You look pale, Mr. Bond. I hope I didn't frighten you.
Well, you see, I've always been a nervous passenger.
Some men just don't like to be driven.
No, some men just don't like to be taken for a ride.
You know what Terence did? He was such a joker. Terence, we would go see the Russians, you know, the Danes, whatever you call them. And he played games. So, for instance, talking about that scene, he put behind us. They used a backdrop for the road.
Yeah.
But what did he do? He put a backdrop just for us. He told whoever it was, the editor, to put in the dailies an ocean behind us. So it looks like we are with a car in the middle of the ocean. And so it was a surprise. Everybody laughed. Or, for instance, there is a scene where Sean is behind the bar and he came in and he's all dressed up from his waist up. And he panned after he finished the scene and Sean said his lines. He had the cameraman pan down and the bar was open in a sense that there was no, it had legs. It wasn't a solid piece of wood. So he pans down and then we see Sean in his shorts, practically his underwear, all naked legs and a pair of slippers on. And that was, Terence was continuously having a good time. That's why we remember this as a happy, happy picture.
Oh, like you said, you did No Time to Die with him, and then you did The Klansman with him afterwards, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, well, could you tell us a bit about that film? Because it seems to have been a bit forgotten. It sounds brilliant.
Well, The Klansman was a very... It wasn't a fun picture to do.
Oh, right. Oh, sorry to hear that.
Because, unfortunately, we had the two stars, Lee Marvin and Richard Burton.
Yeah, amazing, yeah.
Were a little bit temperamental, and Richard was such a wonderful, lovely man, really wonderful. Had a problem with alcohol at the time, and we never know if they showed up in the morning on the set, so there was always a lot of tension. And instead, the one that was adorable and so sweet was...
O.J. Simpson.
O.J. Simpson, yeah, right, yeah. O.J. O.J. was an angel.
Oh.
Such a nice human being. I remember shooting scenes at night where it was cold. We would be there until 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And I saw him one night get up from his chair and go to an extra that was in the movie, an older lady. And he said, please, I don't want you to sit on the floor. Come and sit on my chair. That's how OJ was right at the time. What happened to him after, you know, it's too bad, because he was like really a lovely human being.
Yeah, that's nice of you to say so. Yeah, we haven't heard that before.
Drugs and alcohol are not really a good thing.
No. Gosh. Well,
yeah.
We also wanted to mention your death scene, because that is another highlight of the film. Just filming that, was it? Because you have a nice dance with Sean, and then I'm afraid that's it, isn't it? Were you gutted that you had to die?
That was the script.
Yeah.
There is really nothing that I can comment. I had to die, so yeah. I thought that was a great death scene. And this line also was very cute when he puts me down.
May I cut in? You should have told me your wife was here.
Do you come here often?
It's no good you trying to escape, Mr. Bond.
I don't want to escape. Strange as it may seem, I've grown accustomed to your face.
Why don't you come with us quietly?
You don't seem to understand. You see, I enjoy my dancing. Friend sits this one out. She's just dead.
And I just saw the drummer in the Bahamas.
Oh yes,
again.
Of course, yeah.
He's still alive and drumming away as well as he did 50 years ago.
That's
the
fantastic.
Same strength, the same passion, adorable, yeah, wonderful.
Oh. And I mean, John Barry is one of the stars of the film as well. I don't know whether you had much interaction with him.
No, none.
Oh, good. Okay.
None. Sorry to say. That was post, you know, and no.
Because you get your own theme, you see. You have your own sort of spectre theme with you. Do you still have your ring? Because we love that ring. It looks amazing.
No. I'll tell you something. If I would have kept all of the wardrobe and all the things, but a fan gave me one just recently, maybe 4 or 5 months ago. They made reproductions, and this gentleman brought me a box. We were doing a show somewhere, one of the autograph shows.
Okay.
And he brought me a box, and he said, I want you to have this. And I opened it, and he had bought it for me. And I found out later by from somebody else that it cost him, you know, for somebody who's just a fan to spend $400 or $500, it's a nice present.
Oh.
Yeah, and so I do have one now. I don't like it. Mine was better, but I had to give it back to wardrobe, and I'm so sorry I didn't ask to keep it.
Oh.
Who knew, you know?
Well, you've got all those amazing outfits as well. You know, the blue outfit that you wear to the Junkanoo, and when you're shooting as well.
Oh yeah.
Did you do any of the shooting when it was with Adolfo Celli, wasn't it, that scene?
Yes, with Adolfo Celli. You know what I saw that blue outfit? We were in Dubai.
Okay.
When was it? 2 years ago, 2-3 years ago. We were on our way to India, and they had in Dubai. They had a huge show where they had all the things from, they put together all the items that they from different Bond movies.
Yeah.
So we decided to go and take a look. We walked from room to room, corridors, and it was enormous, and saw so many different things from different movies. And all of a sudden, I turn around the corner, and there is this huge photograph of me. I mean, it must have been 8-9 feet tall. And then next to it, there was a cabinet with glass, and there was my mannequin with my blue dress and the blue boa on it.
The boa,
so, yeah, it was fun. That's where I saw it recently. Well, 2-3 years ago, whatever. Oh.
It's lovely.
I'm presuming the golden slippers are still missing, though.
The golden.
I'm joking. We got the golden slippers that Sean Connery gives you in the bath.
Yeah. Well, I don't know where those are.
Oh.
Yeah. Sorry. No, I have no clue.
Oh dear. We mentioned Adolfo Celli. How was he as an actor? Because another prominent Italian actor. That must have been nice to have him on set with.
No.
You
know, I used to not to. They're gone, and I should be nicer.
Oh.
But the truth is the truth. Adolfo again was very full of himself. Not really pleasant. It's okay. I didn't have that many scenes with him, so it was fine.
That's interesting,
but,
though.
I didn't fall in love, no.
No. Well, I think the two of you are sort of both desperate to kill Bond, and in the end, you say, no, I want to do it. I think you're the stronger character, and in the end, he fails, doesn't he? He fails his mission, and you had a better time of it with Bond, I think.
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. Boy, you know this picture upside down.
We really do.
Yeah. I want to see a photo of the two of you. You're going to email me.
Yeah, we will do,
the two of you. Will you do that?
We will. We can't promise to be as good-looking as Sean Connery, though, unfortunately.
Well, listen, it is, you know, good looks don't mean anything. It's what's inside the brain and the heart that is the most important thing.
We've got a real heart for James Bond, and we do mean it when we say that your character has been pioneering for the series. We wish we could have more strong female characters, because often they sort of say every new Bond film, yes, this is the new Bond girl who's, you know, better than all the rest that's come before. She's stronger. And we say, well, no, they've been doing it since Thunderball with Fiona. You know, your legacy is, if you could see the love you get online from Bond fans saying how much they love your character, I think you'd be overwhelmed, Luciana.
Well, it really makes me feel good. I would think that for the time where really strong women characters didn't exist that much, it was wonderful. Now the leading ladies, the one that plays the leading lady, are stronger than they used to be. They're more interesting.
Yeah.
So it's a whole new generation, you know, everything is changing. I have, I got a lot of satisfaction out of this movie, I have to say.
Yeah. Well, you retired from acting early, didn't you? You have a wonderful gift, we do think that.
I retired early because I fell in love. And 43 years later, because that's how long it has been since I've been married to Michael, we still adore each other, we have fun together, we cry together at commercials where a little dog is lost, whatever. And we are so compatible. And, you know, when I decided to get married, I was married once, very briefly, and I had a son. But then I was alone for many, many years, and I really didn't want to get married again. But when I met Michael, I just thought, you know, I had so much fun from the age of 14 until, for years, I worked for 27 years,
yeah.
And I had a great, you know, great life. Maybe not the career I would have wanted to have, but it was what it was. And so I was at the point where I said, but I don't really have a fulfilling life as a woman, as a wife, as a, you know, I had my mom and my son, and that was the family. I was like the father. I went away to work to support my family, but that was it. So when I met Michael, I said, I'm taking a chance here, because he was traveling a lot, because I don't know if you know anything about him.
Yes, well, we
but
do.
Right. If you look him up, you know what a career he had.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah.
And he was traveling a lot because of that. So I said, if I go one way to make a movie, I go to Japan, and he has to be in France, we will never be together. So I said, I'm going to stop my career as an actress and see how, you know, life, if I can have what I didn't have until now. As you know, if you don't work for 3-4 years in the movie business, at a certain point they say, you want to come back? And they say, Luciana who? So, because everything goes so fast and furious. But thank God that was the best decision I ever made in my life. And so that's why I stopped young, because of him. And I don't regret one day.
Oh, so that's so lovely to hear. And refreshing, really refreshing. And you sound like you've had a wonderful time.
Are you guys married?
We are. Yes, we are both married. Yes, we are.
No, I said I just wish you to have the same happy marriage, fun marriage that I have had.
Oh, that's lovely. Yeah.
That I have.
I've been married to Jennifer now for 10 years, so that's going very well. Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
I've been married to my wife, Rachel, for 8 years. We have 2 children. And my wife, Rachel, she's actually half Italian. So there's a connection
is?
There. Yeah, yeah. She spent half,
oh,
she
really?
Spent some years living in Bari.
Oh, in Bari?
In Bari, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wonderful. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
I'm very happy to hear that. We have a granddaughter whose name is Rachel.
Oh.
She lives in New York. Yeah. Yeah.
Wonderful. You've been absolutely amazing, Luciana. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Amazing for
I would
guys.
Love to meet you one day.
Yeah.
And so send me a photograph of you guys. We come back to England, which I will, I'm sure.
Luciana, you've made our dreams come true this evening for us. This is wonderful. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for every nice word you said to me. Made my day.
Thank you, Luciana. You've made our day very
thank
much so.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You can also hear our massive review of the film Thunderball, where we heap yet more praise on Luciana's wonderful performance.